What's up, people? I'm Zogue, and welcome back to the continuation of the Sanguimancy Mod Spotlight. Now, yes, there are chickens following me, and I have already recorded the items version of this mod, the items portion. Now, I wanted to re-record this because I didn't feel that I captured all of the items. I wanted to get through all of them, so we're going to do this a little bit more streamlined, and we'll be able to get to everything. So, the first one on the list, let's F1. Let's just look at the book this way. The first one is the blood amulet. So that's what we're going to jump into now. The first thing to know about the blood amulet is how to make it. So you need a couple pieces of string, an empty bucket, a demonic slate, which is an imbued slate, tier 4 in the blood altar with 15,000 LP. Not too big a deal. You also need a clock, which again is pretty easy, especially in a modded Minecraft world, your magician's blood orb, and 2 tier 1 blood tanks. Now, that's all good and well. How do you, what is it used for? So if we go back right here, it says the blood amulet is an item that will restore your health if it is under 5 hearts. It costs more than can be gained by sacrificing yourself, even with a tier 5 rune of self-sacrifice altar. Now that second part we'll get to in a minute, but what does it mean here? So basically, if you hold it in your inventory and it is filled with blood, it'll heal you as soon as you go under 5 hearts. It's pretty cool. Now, that second part, why would that even be in there? Well, if you think about it, and you have this guy, you make this guy, you stand here with a self-sacrifice altar, and you're like, I can just get infinite blood? It's not going to work that way. Because the blood you give to this is not as much as this takes when it heals you. So it might heal you 5 hearts, but it's not going to... you're not going to be able to use it infinitely in this guy, basically. You're not going to be able to gain blood that way. Anyway, doesn't... gold block, get out of my way. Diamond block, get out of my way. Nether brick, go away. So, anyway, how do you fill this guy up? How do you use this guy? Well, if you go... No, down... I said... What? No. Here, 2. Thank you. Now, he's talking about blood tanks, which I want to mention anyway, because blood tanks are pretty... It's pretty cool. Well, that's not how you spell blood. So... You have your tier 1 blood tank. How do you make this guy? Obsidian, red stained glass, 2 blank slates, and your orb. That's not too big of a deal. What does it do? It holds 16,000 millibuckets. You know what else holds 16,000 millibuckets? The open blocks tank. It's the same thing. It does the same... Wait, 32? 64? How high does this thing go? How many holy crap tiers are there? That's a lot of liquid you can store in one... tank. 1 block. That's a huge tank. Tier 16. But how do you get these other guys? Well, tier 2 uses tier 1 in this shape with a demonic slate, your blood orb, and some more red stained glass. Alright, cool. So tier 1, what is tier 2? What is tier 3? Tier 2, same shape. Tier 4, tier 3, same shape. Let's just skip right to the 16. You need tier 15. So the basic idea is that you can use the previous tier to get the next tier, which I absolutely love. It's the best thing a mod author can do is allow people to use the lower tier for the higher tier stuff. It just makes sense to me to upgrade rather than make your blocks obsolete and then you don't, you know, have a use for them and they're just taking up storage space. It's ridiculous. But this guy, Tom Ben, has done it right. That is the right way to do it, ladies and gentlemen. That is just perfect. Anyway, so that's how you get the extra tiers. The basic idea is that the higher in tier you go, the more liquid it stores, which is really, really handy. Really, really, really cool. So how do you fill this guy up? Well, you can plop it on the ground and fill it up with a bucket. That'll work. I imagine other ways work too. I'm definitely not going to go all that in depth in how to fill up a blood tank, but just experiment with it. Play with it, guys, and there you go. Then, if you look here, I hold shift. It does nothing. If I right click on it, a bunch. Oh, the tank is empty. Oh, there's 9,000 life essence. Holy crap! What does that mean? It means it works. Ladies, it's done. You're just carry it around. Fill it up as much as you want. Hey, tank. Be a thing, and then get more blood, amulet. Perfect. 18,000. 18,000. Okay, so texture issue. Oh, there it goes. It fixed itself. So, anyway, that's pretty much how the blood amulet works. What's next? Let's see. We go back, Soul Chunk Claimer. We're going to get into this a little bit more in depth when we actually do the Soul Network Dimension. That's going to be another video in the future. We'll get to that. Crafting items are items only used in crafting recipes. They're pretty cool, though. You see right here, minimum corruption, 50. Duration, 500. What does this mean? I will show you in a little bit because there's an item that helps with this. Now, this is in a regular blood altar. Now, you see the difference? See the color of this guy right here? This is a corruption thing. This is a blood altar thing. And then here's just a regular crafting recipe using a wither skeleton and a diamond and a gold ingot and some stone. You get a corrupted mineral. Now, these things are used in various different things. This is just the imbued stick. You know, and it just tells you how to get some of these random things used in random recipes. And
all right, so the corrupted catalyst, let's go ahead and read the book, The Corruption Catalyst. That's what I meant to say.
Is the heart of the corrupted infusion mechanic. Once it is enabled via right-click, as long as you have it in your inventory, any item that you hold and can be corrupted will slowly be transformed into another item. However, this problem? This process is not instantaneous and has a requirement. A minimum level of corruption must be reached before the process starts. So, we mentioned before in the overview that there is this thing that basically you have your own level of corruption. You see right there, I have 0 at the moment. And now, since I'm creative, I can use this little guy right here and get up to the required amount of corruption. Alright, so now the demonstration of this actually doesn't take too much. You see right there, I have soul corruption of 14. Now, if we look, take a closer look at this stuff, this is how you make it. You need tier 3, 3000 LP, and a wither skeleton skull, and it will be transformed into your corruption catalyst. Now, this guy right here, after this page, will find all the corrupted infusion recipes. Which, by the way, that's an awesome name. Corrupted infusion, that's pretty cool. Anyway, so you can turn a potato into a poisonous potato. Well, that's kind of useless. Raw beef and rotten flesh. Sorry, Tom Ben, I don't mean, you know, I get the point, but I mean, it's kind of cool idea. But what? I don't know what it's used for. Somebody let me know. Is there anything in any mod ever that allows you to use a poisonous potato for anything? I'm just curious. Anyway, so you can also turn raw beef into rotten flesh, you know, stone bricks into cracked stone bricks. I mean, a lot of these are kind of, you know, okay, you get 6 bone meal out of a bone. You can turn sand into soul sand. I can see that being useful, you know, in situations where you need soul sand really early, but you can't get to the nether just yet. There you go. You know, and then you have this guy right here, which is one of the crafting things that I mentioned before. And then there's a demon chicken that just, evil chicken minion that just spawned on top of my head. Stone into cobblestone. You know, I mean, there's a lot of these things that can happen. Now, if you've noticed my hotbar, I've chosen to do the raw beef into rotten flesh demonstration. So what in the world does this thing even say? Now, in the book, it says, all you got to do, all you got to do is right click on it and any item that you hold can be corrupted. Okay, so perfect. So if we go to this thing and right click, not shift right click, not control right click, which is never a thing, but you get my point. Just right click and it'll turn it on. And then you have to hold the item. And you see right there, it just totally transformed it right there. Now, this does require a minimum level of corruption, as it says, but it's important to note that it didn't actually take away the corruption. It's just a requirement that you have that much. It's not actually used. So all you really got to do is you can turn as much of this raw beef into rotten flesh as you need, and it's pretty much good to go. That's what it is. It's pretty cool. This next one is one we've already taken a look at just a little bit ahead of schedule because I needed you to understand the point of soul corruption, but it's actually the soul corruption reader. Soul Corruption Reader. This allows you to keep an eye on your soul corruption. So like I was mentioning, you have your own level of soul corruption. Right now, I am at 0 because I negated it with this creative-only item. And I'm about to add some with this creative-only item. Now, there's 12. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There's 17. It's just kind of a thing to keep your eye, you know, that allows you to keep an eye on how much soul corruption you're at. It's very, very handy. Very, very handy, even in creative. So the next thing we're going to take a look at is what it says in the book is any ore lump. By corrupting an ore enough, you seem to be able to get 2 lumps out of the block.
out of the blocks. These lumps are useless by themselves, but once they are cleansed with blood, each lump gives one ingot of the corresponding resource. And right here in the book, it shows the gold and the iron. So we have a couple of those. Well, we'll get a couple of those. Lump. Go ahead and grab myself two of you and two of you. Sure. Then we're going to go ahead and skip ahead in the book to the item that is called the blood cleanser. Now, the blood cleanser in itself, let's go ahead and take a look at this guy. It's not too difficult. You need any ore lump. You know, here's your corrupted infusion, tells you how to get the lumps. And you need two blood tanks, your master blood orb, two blocks of iron, and a block of diamond. So, yeah, okay, it's a little bit expensive, but in reality, if you have anything with a quarry or anything, you're going to have a load of resources. This is actually really cheap. Anyway, so the basic idea with this is that you set this guy down, and if you look in the inventory, you see this right here. This is how much blood you have, and this is your any ore lump. So let's go ahead and drop one iron in there, and you see it's processing it right now. Let's see how much it takes away in order to turn it into it. And it takes 1,000 per lump. So that's okay. We had two. Now this is how you fill it up. You can take a bucket and just right click a few times. And now it's filled up a bunch. And then we have, you know, these things. So we can take out our iron ore and it works like a charm. It's perfect. The next item we're going to look at is actually the wand. We're going to skip the player sacrificing stones because that's part of a larger concept that's going to have its own video. It's going to be an awesome video, but it's not this video. So we're going to skip right to the wand. Now, the wand is something that uses complex spell crystals. And basically, if you're not familiar with those, they allow you to construct these weird looking spell tower line things that basically just have multiple effects. Now, for example, I have the first one here that's go away. We'll send one enemy or one entity flying in presumably the direction you're facing, but not really, just away from you. Whatever is the closest path away from you. So then you have leave me alone, which shoots them all away from you. Then you have zoom, which, well, you've probably seen this something similar to this. It just makes you zoom. It's zoom. Zooming, man. And then you have ice boost. Now, this one is pretty cool. I like this one. Boing. 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 It's pretty cool. I got an ice bounce thing. So, it's cool. Now, what does the wand allow you to do? Now, let's take a look at the book. To add a crystal to the wand, simply right-click the wand with the crystal in your inventory. The crystal will then be consumed and added to the wand. What? That sounds cool. You can overwrite crystals simply by doing the same process as described before, but you cannot get the spell crystal back or change the crystal's coordinates. To cycle through the spell, shift right click the wand. The wand also shows the name of the spell crystal currently selected as a way to differentiate the different spell crystals stored inside of it. Wow. Right click the wand to fire the spell. Sweet. So what does that mean? It means you can store these guys in here because as you see, they take up a lot of hotbar space. So you can have your wand right here. Now, there is a little caveat to this. At the moment, if you right click a wand with more than one spell crystal in your inventory, it will actually consume all of them. And the last one will overwrite the previous, meaning you'll only have whichever one it picks last. So be mindful of that. I have sent a message to the mod author, Tomben. I'm sure he's going to fix that pretty quick. So don't worry too much about it. Chances are we're going to have that sorted out not too far in the future. Anyway, so if I right click, it's now bound and it has spell one and it is here. So then I have, goodbye, goodbye, goodbye. It's pretty cool. Then I can take my second one, leave me alone now. Be mindful, still says current spell one. So what do we do? Shift right click. And now it's on spell two, and you see it's got nothing in it. Nothing in there at all. So then we can right click to bind this one to spell two. Sweet. So then I have leave me alone. Leave me alone, man. Go away. See you later, chickens. Then we can shift right click to set it to spell three. Again, nothing set. So we put take our zoom. And then we have zoom. Zoom. All inside the wand. Then we have ice boost. Still on spell three. Shift, right click, spell four it is, go down here, right click, and we have our ice boost. Boing. Tell me that's not cool. All right, so the next thing we're going to take a look at is the Corrupted Axe. Now, this is part of the Corrupted tool set. There's a whole bunch of tools. We're going to go through them all, but first, the idea is that if you don't have enough soul corruption, then it's not going to work on anything. Like, you won't even be able to break blocks. And the amount of soul corruption you need is in the tooltip. It says minimum corruption to reach the tool's default capability is 200. All right, cool. So then what happens once you reach that? It is it gives it these abilities, right? There's three different modes plus the regular mode. So we're in the regular mode right now. Every time a block is broken and or an entity hit, some life essence from your soul network is consumed. And that's something I don't even have a life essence network at the moment. So you're going to see me actually take damage every time I hit a block as if it's, you know, trying to refill a network that doesn't even exist. But for you, as long as you have blood in your altar or in your network, you'll be fine. Actually, it has to be in your network, not in your altar. I probably should clarify that. Anyway, so the basic idea of this tool is that it has these three extra modes. You have the normal mode, and then the first mode is the decay mode. Now, what this mode does, let's go into survival mode. Turn rain off. I forgot I can do that. Perfect. Now, shift right click first mode. So when I break a block, all the leaves are gone. It's wonderful. And like I said, you saw me take a little bit of damage like that. And you see me little flinch a little bit because I don't have any soul, any blood in my soul network. Anyway, so the next mode is actually the second mode is headhunter mode. Now, I can't exactly demonstrate this too much unless I get really lucky with this guy. I don't even think he drops a head. Where are you going, chicken? You run around like you got your head cut off or something. What's going on? Head didn't get cut off yet. I'm working on it. Oh, I seem to have misplaced a couple of hearts. That's unfortunate. Can I find... Oh, I did it again. All right, so anyway. Now, we did not get a head, and yes, these chickens are dropping stone and cobblestone. It's kind of a thing with these evil chicken minion guys. Anyway, so I can't really test this too well at the moment, but the third mode I can test. Well, the second mode gives you heads, you know, if you kill mobs and stuff. It gives you a higher chance, and the higher your corruption, the better chance you have of actually getting a head. Anyway, the third mode... Ow, I keep misplacing hearts. I need to stop doing that. The third mode... where is it? Next mode? The third and last mode is the refining mode. When a wooden log is broken, six of the corresponding planks will be dropped. When a wooden plank is broken, three sticks will be dropped. Well, that's kind of cool. That's an interesting little thing. Let's play with that a little bit. Log? Oh, planks! More planks. Even more planks. Planks are awesome. Oh, sticks! So that's a neat little thing you can do with this. Oh yeah, I can't fly. I'm in, survival. Starting to take hearts from it. Anyway, so that's the basic idea of this this axe. It's a pretty cool, pretty nifty little thing you can do with this stuff. Anyway, so the next thing we're going to take a look at is the pickaxe. All right, so the pickaxe has five extra modes. It has the same concept. You have to have enough corruption. There's also a thing in here, if you don't have enough corruption and it's not on the basic default mode, you will gain corruption every time you use it. You know, the basic, all the tools have that same functionality, but the modes are what changes. There are five different modes plus the regular mode. Every time it's blocked, okay, it's life essence. And again, I don't have a my soul network. I don't have a soul network, so I am going to, you know, effectively take damage when I try to break these blocks, but doesn't really matter too much at the moment. So the first mode is the Silk Touch mode. The second, third, and fourth modes are the Fortune modes. So Fortune 1, 2, and 3, each adding a level of fortune to the tool. The fifth mode is the Auto Smelting mode. If the block broken can be smelted, the result of the smelting will be dropped. If not, the block will simply be dropped. Okay, so that's pretty cool. So you see Silk Touch, Fortune 1, Fortune 2, Fortune 3, and Smelting. Perfect. So now, Silk Touch, mode 1. Oh, wait, I'm in creative. Hold on, let me try that again. Let me do that without being a derp. All right, Let's try this again. Ow, 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 ow. Oh, look. I got them all back. Wonderful. Okay, so. Fortune 1. Let's see. We got 10 diamonds. All right, cool. Hold on. Let's do this. Wait. No. Let's do this. Get rid of those. So we got 10 diamonds for the first one. Fortune 2. And then we'll go back to creative. Ow. That hurt. I fell from a high distance. Oh. Keep going. You're gonna get bounced around a lot. Okay, 13. That is more. It did work. It did increase it. That's cool. And then we go here. Let's go back to creative. Ow. I fell from a high height. Big height again. And then shift right click for fortune 3. Now you see how the colors went from blue to bluer to bluest. Yes, they are words. I just made them up. And then we're just going to go ahead. Now this is fortune 3. And I'm almost dead. But we got 16 diamonds. So it is working. It is working. The fortune thing and stuff. All that good stuff. It is entirely working. Oh. Ha ha, chicken. Burn. Alright, so now. We go to the last mode, which is auto smelting mode. Hopefully I'm healed enough. It looks like I am. Wonderful. Go away. Now, technically you're not supposed to break wood with a pickaxe, but just to show you that it still works, it totally does. I'm getting charcoal from wood, even though it's wood and you're supposed to break that with an axe. I'm breaking it with a pickaxe on auto smelting mode and it is working. So it is kind of a thing you can do. Oh, am I taking damage? What was going on? Oh. Ow. Anyway, so you understand the concept of that. Let me go back before I die, Creative Plus. And the next thing we're going to take a look at is the shovel. This thing has some cool stuff to it as well. All right, and now we are on the shovel with that lightning strike. That was cool. Anyway, the basic idea about the shovel is pretty much the same thing as the others. It is part of the corrupted tool set. Primary function is to break blocks. Corrupted imbued in it developed other abilities. And I just got blown around. And the basic idea is the same. You need a minimum level of corruption, all that other good stuff. Now, on to the special things. The modes. Where's the first one? The first mode of the corrupted shovel is the breaking down mode. If the block mined is amongst a list of blocks, a ghost image of another block will be displayed on one of the six sides. So, mode one. Oh, you see the six? What? Wow. Okay, that's cool. What does that mean? It means if I dig it, wait. Survival. Oh, it's sand. That's cool. Now, I wanted to show this to you, that even though it's cobblestone, and you're certainly not supposed to dig cobblestone with this, let's see if this works. If we were to dig cobblestone with the shovel, which is definitely the wrong thing, and in regular Minecraft, you would not get the block back for this, because you're effectively breaking it with your hand. But let's see. Yes, it did work. Look at that. Isn't that just amazing? You can turn cobblestone into gravel, and then gravel into sand. That's pretty cool. Anyway, so the next mode is, the second mode is gold digging mode. When breaking gravel with a shovel in that mode, the gravel block will not be dropped. Instead, there is a chance for a diamond, a gold nugget, and an emerald to be dropped. Cool. Let's play with this one. Let's see if we can get anything out of these two rows. Shall we? Okay, I am in survival. Okay, good. Do I get anything? I'm not getting the gravel, that's for sure. Oh, I didn't get anything. Darn. Oh, that's unfortunate. Anyway, so the third mode is the transmutation mode. If the block mined is amongst the list of blocks, a ghost image. This sounds familiar, doesn't it? Now, pay attention to one thing. Third mode is transmutation mode. The first mode is breaking down mode. So the first one broke things down. This one changes things into something else. So we go to the last one right here, the last mode. And now you see grass on top. That's cool. Oh, I can go straight to Podsoul? Yeah, you totally can. Now this is just dirt. And I'm sure there's other blocks both of these things will work on. So go have fun with it. Play with it. Figure it out. Let me know. I'm sure. Just send me a list of blocks that works. That's cool. Anyway, that's the basic idea of the shovel. So, ooh, here, and then here, and then now we have the corrupted blade. Oh, right, now, oh, there was me flying in the air, because soul corruption launches you sometimes, and it spawns these chicken things. So anyway, now we're on the sword. So let's check out the sword. Again, part of the corrupted tool set, you have to have a minimum level of corruption. And what this means specifically for the sword is that if you don't have enough corruption, you're basically punching mobs with your fist. Just thought I'd throw that out there. I learned this one the hard way when I tried to punch one of these guys to death. And these guys have 200 HP. It's a lot of health for a chicken. Anyway, so the basic idea of this is once you get past all of the basics, its special main ability is, let's see, where is it? The tool's ability is the heart-stealing ability. When a player is hit by this sword and the ability is activated, some hearts are taken from the player that was hit and added to the life of the player who holds the sword. Now, the maximum number of hearts that can be stolen is 7.5, which means that one player can be down to 2.5 hearts for a full minute, while another can go up to 17.5 for 1 minute. This can be incredibly handy in PvP situations. This is kind of a cool. I'm not entirely clear on if it works on regular mobs or not. If it did, it'd be pretty cool. But nonetheless, if you like PvP, this is definitely the mod for you. I mean, you gotta check it out. There's also some other PvP-oriented things, which will be discussed in future videos. I apologize for not doing it in this one. But if this video was an hour and a half long, I don't think anybody would watch it. So I have to split it up. And that's kind of the basic idea. Anyway, so after that guy, after this sword is done, you have the Soul Transporter, which is an item that allows you to teleport to the Soul Network dimension. Now, I mentioned already that that will be in another video as well. So, I'm not going to discuss that here. But it does say, do not forget to bring two, as there is no other way in and out of the dimension. Cool, good to know. Now, what we're going to look at now is the Teleposition Sigil. Okay, so the Teleposition Sigil. What does this thing do? Well, let's take a look. Teleposition Sigil is an item that will teleport you to a location previously set. To set that location, simply shift-click on a teleposer with the sigil in hand. Right-click the sigil to teleport back to that location. Teleporting in the same dimension costs 1,000 LP, while teleporting across dimensions costs 10,000 LP. Pretty cool, man! And that's the recipe for it. Two Eyes of Ender, Sigil of Ender Severance. Your blood orb, 200 pearls, 2 end stones, and a piece of obsidian. Now, this is the teleposer, which is a blood magic thing. This is not a sanguimancy thing. This is a blood magic thing. You need gold ingots. You need the teleposition focus, a couple ender pearls. Not a huge deal. This is how you make it, you know, tier 4 and a blood altar, blah, blah, blah. Not too difficult to make. But you place one of these guys down. You go and make your sigil, and you come over to it and shift right click. Now, when you hold shift over it, oh, no, I said I want to be on top of the block. Thank you. Oh, I didn't break it. I swear I didn't break it. I didn't do it. Now, let's try this again without getting bounced around and having chickens, I don't know, doing a lot of things very, very close to me. Anyway, so I am very close to being moved by this. That's sweet. Coordinates. Now, you see the coordinates are set, bound dimension, current owner, blah, 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 all that good stuff. And I can just be like, Oh, wait, I forgot something. I'm back. And so are the chickens. Did you see that? They were like pulled towards me. It was pretty cool. Anyway, that's the basic concept. That's the basic idea of the teleposition sigil. This thing is amazing. I love it. It's pretty great. So what's next? We have the sigil of transposition. Those two words are very, very close to being the same thing, but they're not. Transposition and teleposition. So what does this thing do? Alright, the transposition sigil allows the player to move any block he can break without actually doing so. What? I don't get it. You should, because it's pretty much just like a dolly. So, indeed, shift right clicking on a block with the sigil will store it inside the item if the sigil is empty. Right clicking it again will set the block back in the exact state it was picked up. Now, what this actually means, and I've tested this in several different ways. For those of you who are familiar with Steve's Factory Manager, I can't test it because I don't have the mod installed in this world. Or I would test out the Batania thing with a monopool, and I'd show you that, as well as Steve's Factory Manager, that those of you who know how to set one of those up is very complicated, and once you break the block, you have to reset it again. You have to do everything all over again. It is a thing you have to do, but this guy can pick up those things and place them back down without having to do so. The exact same state is an entirely true statement. So if it has any kind of states, Steve's Factory Manager with all its complicated setup, the monopool, I'm sure, is one of those things. You can just kind of, boom, lightning struck it. Man, it picked it. It's in the thing. Transposition, of course, contains a speed run. Sweet. Go back down, man. What about you now? Boom, it's lightning. I love that. I don't know why. Block of quartz. Put it back down, man. I didn't want that. Can I pick you up? Apparently not. Now, these are not real blocks. In case you haven't noticed, these, once you mine them, they just disappear. Like, you don't get the items. They're not giving you blocks of snow or anything. Just a thing that happens around the area when you have a whole lot of soul corruption. Anyway, so that's the basic idea of these items. There's all of them. Almost. All right, so there's all about the Sanguimancy items. Now, as mentioned, there will be other videos describing other concepts of this mod, but it is kind of big, so there's a lot of things to go over, so they are split up in different videos, all of which, once completed, will be in the description. Thanks for that, Lightning, I appreciate it. So, go check out, you know, the other videos, see what you like, see what you see, and it's gonna be pretty cool. But if you like the video, don't forget to hit that like button. Hello, Gold. If you want to see more, you want my videos sent directly to you, then don't forget to subscribe. Comment, favorite, share if you feel like you want to. Thanks so much for watching, and I will see you next time. Bye.